That's the way a Baptist church ought to sound. I mean, you folks supposed to know where you're going. Now, these Pentecostals know whether they're going to make it or not, and what they're shouting about. We get them down home, you know. We have Pentecostals come to our services sometime, and they sit there, and the racket scares them so bad they just turn white in the face. You know, they can't figure out what's going on. All right, now if you have a Bible mind, let's turn to the Gospel according to Luke, and make it Luke chapter 16, beginning at verse 19. Luke 16, beginning at verse 19. Now, if you read the Bible at all, you're familiar with the story. This is one of those outstanding stories in the Word of God. Certain chapters in the Word of God are outstanding, and you remember them longer than you do the rest. I believe all the Bible is the Word of God from cover to cover. Amen. But there are certain parts in it that have more to them than other parts. And Luke chapter 16, beginning at verse 19, is a story the Lord Jesus Christ tells there. And this story is about hell. Jesus Christ preached on hell 8 times in 3 years. That's better than 2 times a year. So some of you folks have been hanging around churches where the pastor doesn't preach about hell at least 2 times a year. You're not in a very Christian type of situation. Right. You get talking about hell and people say, oh, I believe in the sweet spirit of Christ. Well, the term hellfire comes out of the Sermon on the Mount. First time the word hellfire occurs in the Sermon on the Mount. And these liberals who go around preaching the Sermon on the Mount, they're awful quiet about hell for some reason. They go through there and just take out what they like and throw out what they don't like. And Jesus Christ tells this story. Now, Jesus Christ tells this story beginning at verse 19. The story runs like this. There was a certain rich man, clothed in purple and fine linen, who fared sumptuously every day. And it was a beggar named Lazarus, laid at the gate of the rich man's house, desiring to be fed with the crumbs that fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. Now, this story tells about a rich man and a poor man, and doesn't say whether the rich man was a good man or the poor man was a poor man was a good man or a bad man. You say, well, I know in this story that the rich man must have been a bad man because the rich man winds up in hell, and the poor man must have been a good man because he winds up in heaven. Yeah, but you see, that's why the Lord didn't tell you that, because that isn't true. Sometimes good people wind up in hell, sometimes bad people wind up in heaven. You take a Pharisee there one time and stood and prayed with himself and said, I thank God I'm not as other men, or even as this publican. I'm not unjust, I'm not an adulterer, implying the publican was. And I fast twice a week and tithe and give alms of all that I possess, which is more than some of you do. And you take that kind of thing, that fella, Christ said about that fella, he said he wasn't justified. That was a good man who was lost, and the publican was saved. So you can't always tell by that. So for that reason, when he tells this story, he just leaves out the moral part, and he just says there was a rich man and a poor man. That's all he says. Now, you take that business of money. That's something else. We've got on all our coins, we have a little sign that says, In God We Trust. And there isn't anybody overseas that you're a fool about that. They know what Americans trust. Americans trust money. They know that. You don't fool those people in Europe, Africa, Asia. They got better sense than that. They know what you worship. They worship a dollar bill. Some folks, they squeeze the dollar bill so hard they give George Washington a permanent. I saw something one time real good, which I wish I'd kept. There was some imitation money some guy made up, one of these Mad Magazine type of things, you know. I buy Mad Magazine, you know, I buy that. I take 2 magazines, the National Rifleman and Mad Magazine. I those two. And I only belong to 2 things. I belong to the church, and I belong to the National Rifle Association. I'm a life member of the National Rifle Association. I believe in God, guts, and guns.
Amen.
And I believe that's how you got this country. If you keep this country, if you're missing any one of those elements, you lose this country.
That's right.
Folks say, well, why? I never heard such a militant type. Well, you just don't look too well. Did you ever see that picture of the pilgrims going to church on Thanksgiving?
Yeah.
You know what they got? They got guns. That's the way to go to church, a Bible in one arm, a .38 in the other. That's how to go to church. And you take, so I buy those kind of things, and you take, I saw a picture of a dollar bill one time. It looks like a real dollar bill, except George is like this. And that's the condition of the dollar bill in America today. But you take money. Most folks want more money than what they have. If you got a raise $5 an hour, you wouldn't weep tears over it. The Bible says the love of money is the root of all evil. Now, the new Bibles don't say that. If you have a new King James Bible, it doesn't say the love of money is the root of all evil. Because whoever makes out those new Bibles is hung up on money.
Amen.
When they hit that verse, they change that verse. There's only one Bible in the American continent that says the love of money is the root of all evil. The King James Bible. The rest of them don't say it. You don't believe it? Check it. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 10. Now, the Bible says the love of money is the root of all evil. Somebody says, well, I thought the source was the devil. That's talking about the origin. Paul's talking about the root in the world system, present tense. He didn't say the root was. He said the root is. The root of all the trouble in San Diego is loving a buck.
That's right.
Drug traffic? Buck. Rock music? Buck. Pornographic stuff? Buck. Cat houses? Buck. Prostitution? Buck. Trying to get the money by the drugs? Buck. It's a buck. It's a buck. Trouble between your neighbors, government affairs, dollar bill, dollar bill, dollar bill. The love of money is the root of all evil. Now, you understand, he didn't say it was money that was the root of all evil. They misquote that thing sometimes, you know, and say, well, money is the root of all evil. It doesn't say that. It says the love of money is the root of all evil. You know, it isn't having money that damns you. It's loving it that damns you. And just because you're rich, I don't mean you're damned. And just because you're poor, I don't mean you're blessed either. You know, some folks get an idea because they're dirt poor, they have special favor with God nobody else has. That isn't true. There are some poor people that love money just as much as rich people do. Except they're worse off because they don't have it. And you take that business, the love of money is the root of all evil. Some people go after that, they make it the life goal. If you're from up north, you're a Yankee, you're bad on that. You're bad on that. Most northerners, they don't know how to learn how to live, they don't know how to make a living. Up there, right up there in New York. Don't tell me. I'll tell you. I preach all over Rochester and Green Bay and Flint, Michigan, and Lance, Michigan, and Pittsburgh, and Al Quipper. I know what's going on up there. Those folks up there right now striking because they're only getting $10 an hour. Gee, what a tough break. If you can't live off $10 an hour, blow your brains out. If you don't know how to be happy in $10 an hour, there's something wrong with you. I mean, really. You say, well, the stuff real high, yeah, but if you know how to enjoy life, you can enjoy life on that kind of money. Don't kid me. And all that stuff, some folks, they just get all they can all they get and sit on the lid and wait for the undertaker to come. Those old northerners up there in Illinois and Indiana, they just work their fingers, the bone all their life, and they come down to Sarasota and Fort Myers and St. Petersburg and kick the bucket. And some of them kick the bucket before they ever get there. And some of them kick the bucket a week after they get there. One of the most pitiful things you ever see in your life, you go to St. Petersburg and go to the K-pop tree. That big high-class, I call it a high-class dump. I realize I'm kind of crude. It's supposed to be an elite restaurant. I call it a high-class dump. And you go there and see those old Yankees sitting around there all wrinkled up, and those old women look like a 30-year Navy man sitting around there, and they're all painted up like a possum hunter in pokeberry time, got a cigarette in the end of a pole, just waiting for the devil to kick him off into hell. Pitiful, pitiful. They spend all their life trying to keep up in Cadillacs and jewels all over and look like a Christmas tree. For what? Man, we got color folks in our town that make $50 a week that live better than that. I mean, they do. They do. The love of money is the root of all evil. It'll get you. It'll get you. The best things in life money can't buy. You're saying that all my life, but I'm not convinced. Well, maybe I can convince you before tonight's over. You know, a fellow says the only thing money can't buy is poverty. One of those fellows says, no, it's not the love of money at the root of all evil. It's the lack of money that's the root. They got all kind of little things they say, you know, about trying to get the way around the thing. One time they said about a certain rich fellow, said, how much did he leave? And a Christian said he left it all. You know how much you leave? You leave the whole thing. Go on, be stupid. Bat your brains out. Try to make a lot of money. What are you going to do with it when you get it? You should give it to your kids. How do you know it won't damn them? If your kids are worth anything, they'll make their way without it. And if they're not worth anything, you'll do worse for them to have it. You'll get up there around 70, 80 and be lying around the hospital, and all your kids around taking care of you, and each one of them trying to see who can take care of the best care of you to get the most money. You're a fool to make money your goal. You know, one of the great hardest charges that God ever gave a young preacher, he gave Timothy. You know the charge Paul gave Timothy? Paul told Timothy, he said, charge them that are rich in this world, that be not high-minded, but trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God. You know, that's a hard charge to give to a young preacher. Money being what it is these days, and you have to get money to get land, and have to money to buy a building, and have to have money to fix buses, and have to do money to get tracks to do the Lord's work. You need money all the time. I don't know of any fundamentalist in America who's got more money than he can handle. But you're to charge those rich folks, don't be high-minded. Don't trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God. And you're told to charge them out, you've got to charge them out. There's a charge. The best things in life money can't buy. And yet, if this rich fellow lived in San Diego, most Baptist churches would be trying to make a deacon out of him, you know. And the Presbyterian churches trying to make an elder out of him, you know. And the Presbyterian would try to make a vestry out of him. And the old man so-and-so down there got enough money, he could fence the whole place with gold fence posts and all that kind of thing. You know how to talk. Best things in life money can't buy. You say, well, I'd like to hear that proved. I'll prove it to you. I'll tell you some things about tonight that the best, some good things in life money can't buy. I don't care how rich you are, you can't buy them. You take what's his name? Rudyard Kipling, the British poet laureate. When he got well up in years, about to retire, they asked him to come to Oxford or Cambridge. I think it was Oxford, to talk to the young man, lecture them. And he lectured them. He was rather impressed rather negatively by their fine clothes and their fine manners. And when he got through with his speech, he said something very significant. He said, I notice most of you young men are very well healed, and evidently your fathers have a lot of money, and you've come from wealthy backgrounds. And he said, someday, when you get out in the world after you graduate here, and someday when you come down the line, you're going to meet a man somewhere to whom those things mean nothing. And he said, when you do, you'll realize how poor you are. Now, the best things in life money can't buy. You say, like what? Well, how about the love of a good woman? I mean a good woman. I don't mean a dog. I don't mean a tramp you'd buy for Coca-Cola and a hamburger. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about a good woman. Where do you buy that? Let me ask you this. Can you buy forgiveness of sins with money? Can you buy heaven with money? The best things in life money can't buy. Can you buy your own children with money? No. God will give you your own children. You won't have any children. We have couples come to our church. Our church is a baby factory, man. We've got 35 kids in the nursery under 5 years old. 35 of them, man. And 50 of them between 4 and 10. I mean, we have a baby shower around there. It's a thunderstorm, man. It's a hurricane. And every now and then we have coming to that school, some young couple, you know, where they've been married 4 or 5 years, no children. It's hard on a woman come to our church and have no children. Hard on her, boy. I mean, there's some baby shower every other week. And I tell them if they can't have any children, they'll adopt children. I always tell them that. I believe in that. I believe if you don't have any children, you'll adopt children. I don't care how old you are, how poor you are. I wouldn't even worry about it. I'd adopt children. You say, well, I'd find out what life's all about. I believe that 80% of life is kids and dogs. I believe that. And I believe if you haven't got kids and dogs, a lot about life you just don't know anything about. Now, you take children, they're a blessing to have children. You say they're a pain in the neck. Yeah, I know about that, too. You say, well, you ever get mad at your children? Yeah, I've been mad enough at them sometime to shoot them. They wear on you, tear, and get in your nerves, but they're worth it. You say they grow up and they step in your apron strings, you know, and then step in your heart strings. I know, that's true. And sometimes they're a big disappointment to you and a responsibility and a burden to you, but they're worth it. They're worth it. You can't buy your own baby. God Almighty gives your own baby, you won't have your own baby. The best things in life money can't buy. Where can you buy a healthy constitution? Where do you buy good health? I'm not talking about getting well after you get sick. I'm not talking about affording a doctor. I'm not talking about that. Where do you buy a naturally healthy constitution that can stand the ravages of time year in and year out, without falling apart? Where do you buy one of them things at? You know, some, if you could find a way to sell them things, you'd have people line up around this world 50 deep, 20,000 miles around the equator trying to get one of them bodies. But you can't buy them. You've got one and you don't. I say the best things in life money can't buy. And I'll convince you for them, Drew. Years ago in this country, there was a rich man. We've had rich man off and on, but I guess one of the richest was Cornelius Vanderbilt. And Vanderbilt wasn't a pauper like John Paul Getty and old Charles Hughes. They were down there, you know, they're down there with the poor folk. When Cornelius Vanderbilt died, he left behind $75 million. I don't mean stocks holding bonds. I mean 75 million smackers, Iron Man, cash, boy. I mean 75 million to most of the family and 50 million to most of the family and 25 million to his oldest boy in cash. That fella could have hired, he could have hired Howard Hughes' pair of fingernails. And now the boy, when you ever see his home up there in Carolina, you ought to see that place. Well, how many bedrooms, bathrooms? 25 bedrooms, 17 bathrooms, all that stuff. Do you ever stop thinking about how stupid that is? What, you get up and move from each bed at night, go down, sleep in 15 bedrooms? You only sleep one bedroom at a time. You could just walk through there looking at the bed, People crazy. And he sat down there one time at a table and ordered his old salad with no vinegar and oil and his Melba toast, He had bleeding ulcers so bad he couldn't hardly stand it. And some college kid came in and sat down next to him and ordered one of those topsy-flopsy, floatsy-moatsy, something like that, big old jumbo ice cream, banana split junk all over that thing, and sat there eating that thing. And you know what he said? He turned to his mail secretary and he said, He said, I'd give half what I'm worth if I'd eat a meal like that. Where do you buy a good stomach? They're not for sale. That's right. I'm blessed with a good stomach. God bless me. I get sick of my stomach about once every 6 years, something like that. I eat all over this country. I go up north and eat you Yankees, English peas. And that white bread, you got a white bread, push it together, so the air goes out of it, And that iced tea they serve up there, you clean out a shotgun barrel of that stuff, brother. The ice for iced tea, they bring you the thing that big, got two lumps of ice in the top, That's what I think iced tea is, that kind of stuff. And sit down and eat that stuff, and lasagna, and spaghetti.
Glory.
Brother, let's don't be sacrilegious tonight. All that food up there tastes like a bed sheet or sand or something. It tastes like you're chewing a pillowcase or something. It's peculiar. It's starch. You go in there, lasagna, noodles, spaghetti, and bread. Pancakes, waffles, blah, blah, blah. But I can eat it. And don't make me sick. I come down to Louisiana and eat that crayfish biscuit and that Philly gumbo and put enough Tabasco sauce in there and light up a fire with, boy. I eat down south, they just make a bill of fire and put it out. I can sit down and eat jalapenos whole, take vinegar and drink it raw, drink the vinegar out of the glass, take that brine that pickled olives in and drink that, chew an onion, eat a piece of garlic, and I won't even belch. That's right. God been good to me, man. Give me a cast iron belly. And I'm glad of it, too. You can't buy them. Years ago up there and around Lake Michigan, Bob Jones Sr. had a meeting. He was just a young preacher then, in his early 20s. And he had a meeting up there at the home of a rich man. And I forget what he said the fellow's house cost, $4 million, something like that. Of course, the house wasn't that much. The house was about $500,000. But it was on $1 million worth of property and had a $2 million yacht out there in the bay anchored up and all this and that. And he sat down in that fellow's house and sat down at the table to eat. And the fellow and his wife had supper that night. It was just the two of them and Bob Jones. And Bob Jones sat across the table and the man sat at one end of the table. His wife sat at the other end of the table. And he said that table was so long he'd a Pony Express to get a message from one end to the other. And he said he sat down at that table after a while. He noticed a high chair across the table from him while he was reading. And he said to the man, do you have a child? And when he said that, the man got kind of nervous, and the woman dropped her head and looked down at her plate. And the man said, well, yes. He said, about 4 or 5 years ago, God gave us a little boy. And he said he lived for 2 years, and then the Lord took him. And he said, we tried to move that high chair away from the table, but we just don't seem to be able to move it, so we just let it sit there. That fella had $1 million worth of junk in his house. He had carvings and tapestries from Egypt and original urns and vases from Greece and hand paintings originals by Tintoretto that cost him $500,000 in that house. Now, that fella happened to be a saved fella. Can you imagine what happened if that fella had been unsaved? Can't you see that fellow walking through that museum he had for a home and stopping in front of those statues and saying, speak to me, help me. God just taken my little boy. You cost me so much. Comfort me. Say something to me. You can't say nothing to you. That money can't do it. It's good for nothing. Going to come a time in your life, you're going to get in a place where unless the Holy Spirit comforts you and gets you through, you're going to make the biggest mess you ever saw in your life. And money ain't going to have nothing to do with it. Listen, some of the biggest drunken slobs in this town are doctors and lawyers and bankers that make $200,000 a year. Don't kid me. Don't kid me. I've been around too long. They're drinking themselves to death. You know why? No comforter. The best things in life money can't buy. Like I just said. There was a certain rich man clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a beggar named Lazarus, laid at the gate of the rich man's house, covered with sores, desired to be fed with the crumbs that fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked their sores. Why, the rich man, the poor man. You say, fellow's a beggar? Yes, says he's a beggar. You say, could there be such a thing as a Christian beggar? Don't you know in this story the poor man winds up saved, winds up in heaven? Yes. Well, if he winds up in heaven, then he's a saved man. How could there be such a thing as a Christian beggar? Doesn't the Bible say, I have been young and I'm now old, I've never seen the righteous forsaken or his seed begging bread? Yeah, that's what it says. Doesn't the Bible say, my God shall supply all your need to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus? That's what it says. You say, well, how in the world could this fellow be saved then and be begging? Well, I'll tell you how that works. Sometime when a nation turns its back on God and turns its back on God and turns its back on God, the saved people suffer right along with the unsaved people. There were good people in Jerusalem that suffered plenty when Nebuchadnezzar came in and tore that place down, and when Titus came in. Sometime the righteous suffer right along with the unrighteous. Solomon has something to say about that. And I don't relish the day and look for the day when I'll see you or my kids trying to get their food out of a garbage can, but it's happened in other countries.
That's right.
Americans think they're immune. Americans are spoiled. They're spoiled. You're spoiled. You drove here in a car tonight. Most of you didn't walk. You drove in a car. I've seen them come to meet in the back end of a tractor. I've seen them walk 5 miles in their bare feet in South Alabama. And over in Russia, why, they'd have been glad if they could have walked 5 miles to get to a service. Americans are spoiled. They gripe. They complain. They bellyache. Some of you haven't thanked God for your breath today, and the people in the hospital are strangling to death. Some of you haven't thanked God for your feet today, and there are people who don't have any feet. Americans are spoiled. You say, I don't have much of a car. You may not have much of a car, but the thing got you here. I mean, I'll admit it might be a rolling pile of junk. Might have got here one piece at a time, but it got you here. Over in Pensacola, we had a guy go across the toll bridge there, you know, and it said 25 cents. He came clanging across there and rattling across there in some junk heap he'd kept together for about 15 years. And the guy at the toll bridge said 25 cents, and he said, sold. But you got here. And you take Americans as spoiled. Oh, the Bible says all nations forget God shall be turned into hell. Righteous exalts a nation, but sinners are approached in any people. And someday God's going to settle accounts with America. Bob Jonas used to say God won't take from America what he'll take off other nations. And the reason why he won't is because America's had too many advantages and too many privileges other nations didn't have. And God won't take off this country what he'll take off other nations. If I got back home in a couple of weeks, I'd pick up a newspaper and read this whole seaboard of California from Frisco to San Diego dropped off in the water and cost about 8 million people their lives. I might be sad about it when I remembered you after having met you and your pastor and some of Brother Batum's people up there and Rasmussen's people. I remember the Christians were here, but I wouldn't be surprised. I might feel sad about it. I wouldn't be shocked. Not me. The way they live out here, the only thing that keeps you people from just going to perdition is a bunch of people still be that book and still pray it.
Right.
But any time you think you're a minority, just step outside that door and look. The Bible says righteous exalts a nation, but sinners are approached to any people. The trouble is all the nations keep thinking they're something different, something unique. That's the problem. The Bible says all the nations that forget God should be turned into hell. Somebody's not America. Yeah, America. America. Listen, I've stood in a chow line, taken my mess kit, gone to a chow line, and scraped my mess kit out into a tin can, where a little old kid stood there with a tin can and took that garbage and took it home for his mother and daddy to eat. I've been in Japan after World War II. You couldn't find her a dog or a cat in Tokyo anywhere. You know why you couldn't find them? Because they ate them. And I've been in there. I've gone by those trestles at night, those electric cranes go over, and I've seen kids 10, 11, 12 years old, 100 of them, pile up in a ball sleeping together at night under those trestles. No mother, no father, no aunt, no uncle, no nothing. And the snow come down at night, cover them up. Get up in the morning, shake the snow off them, go around and try to find something to eat. Got a friend that adopted a little Korean boy after that mess was over, a Christian couple of mine. They adopted a little Korean boy, and they wondered, do you know what he was doing during the daytime? He'd disappear for a while, and they wouldn't see him for a while. He'd be chewing or something, and they couldn't figure out what it was, and they finally was catching flies and eating them. The kid had learned when he was starving in Korea, go down the alleys and catch flies and eat the flies. Americans are spoiled. When I came back from World War II, I came back to Frisco to the Golden Gate up yonder. When I came back to the Golden Gate up yonder and looked up there and saw the shoreline up there and those houses up there, those little white houses, I knew what was up there. I knew it was up there. Cars in the garage, you know, and a deep breeze and the radio, you know, and that kind of thing. And I'll tell you, a feeling of bitterness came over me. If somebody caught me when I first got back from overseas, I'd have made a good communist candidate. I really would have. I've been over there in the Philippines, and I've seen people live over there whose house was a platform and a tree. I don't mean a thatched roof. There wasn't any roof on the thing. The thing was a platform and a tree. That's where they lived. And you come back to America and see that stuff, and you wonder. You wonder. Listen, any time this country gets thinking God bless it because it's democratic or capitalistic or right-wing, you're headed for a crack-up. I'm here to tell you, and I'm not worried about apologizing to anybody now or later, and my mind is just as closed on it and just as dogmatic and narrow-minded and bigot as any bigoted bigot that ever lived. I'm here to tell you the only reason God has blessed this country is because this country so far has read that book and believed that book and tried to do something about it.
Amen.
And if it weren't for that book, this country would have been buried in hell 100 years ago.
Amen.
It's that book. You take care of that book, God take care of you. Let that book go to pot, you go to pot, and your whole nation with you. All this business, capitalistic, democratic. Oh, cut it out. You're killing me, man. These capitalists just have many sins the communists do. They'll skin you out of a buck as quick as they will or quicker. You take a communist, that's all he is. Just a capitalist don't have any money. That's all he is. All that kind of business, all that mess. You know, one day Greece said, we're the greatest country on the face of the earth. Nobody's like the Greeks. We have the orators, Demosthenes, and Euclid, and Pythagoras, the mathematicians. We've got the philosophers, Socrates, and Plato, and Aristotle, and Maximenes, and Anaximander, and we're the greatest, most intelligent, cultured people upon the face of the earth. And God sent the Roman legions in there and wiped them out. And one day Rome said, all roads lead to Rome. Rome is the eternal city. And you know what God did? God took those Vandals, those Visigoths, and Huns, and Vandals, and Ostrogoths, and sent them down there and wiped out Rome and burned it to the ground. And one day those Goths, those Germanic tribes, and Huns, and Visigoths, and Vandals said, Deutschland, Deutschland, über alles, today, Germany, tomorrow, the world. And before God got through with them, the women were selling themselves for chocolate bars in the streets. When the Russian came through, they're dragging off by the hair on the tanks. No country ever got away with it. Babylon didn't get away with it. Persia didn't get away with it. Greece didn't get away with it. Rome didn't get away with it. Germany didn't get away with it. One day England said, Britannica rules the waves. The sun never sets on the British Empire. Well, brother, it just done set. It just done went down. There isn't any British Empire. England, they is a fifth-rate world power. Japan, Russia, West Germany, United States, and probably Israel are ahead of England. Well, that place today is just a bunch of drunken witch worshippers, beetle, dopehead, slapping each other with pubs downtown. Nothing left that country. While some of you people have eaten better in the last week than some of the rich people over there have eaten in the last 2 months. You don't believe it? Why don't you go and check me out? Broaden your education. You know what England did about 1904? It got rid of its King James Bible. And 1904, the British Foreign Missionary Society said, no more texts or susceptus in the mission field. The British Foreign Missionary Society said, let's take that German text from Nestle's and let's use that as the basis of a missionary translation. God said, you do, I'll shut every missionary door you got. And China went, and India went, and all the rest of it went. The sun never set the British Empire. Well, it set. And I'm here to tell you, if this country doesn't get right, God's going to take this country, God's going to clean house. God, no respecter of nations. This country doesn't get rid of its nude women and its dirty billboards and its pornographic literature and its adult movies and quit placating all these lesbians and appealing all these queers for votes. The love of money is the root of all evil.
Yes.
See? God's going to take his place. Bomb her out. Bomb her out. Never been any change. Americans are ungrateful. They're unthankful. They're unholy. I get sick when I think about it. I still get a thrill when I hear the Star Spangled Banner, but I must admit it's not a thrill of bravery and glory. It's a tearful, tragic thing to hear. I hear almost weak, and not because it stirs me up. When I think about those words, or does that Star Spangled Banner still wave, or the land of the free and the home of the brave, I don't have a laugh or cry. The home of the brave, you can't even sell your house to the people you want to sell it to. You can't even advertise in the paper what kind of help you want for your kids for discriminating against somebody. Land of the free, you're afoot. I protest all I can. I notice your brother, your pastor, he's a good man. When he goes to a restaurant and says, please wait to be seated, he waits. I never do. I go to a restaurant, I go right in and sit down. They say, the table hasn't been cleared yet. Just shut up. I'm paying the bill. I get sick and tired of going to these places and have the waitresses put you on charge to give you an exam to see if you'll meet their demands. I'm getting the shaft. I'm paying the bill. They are there to wait on me. Amen, amen, amen. Now, some of you folks don't like that, see? You know what it is? You're shot already, man. You're already gone. You succumb to the system.
Amen.
Protest, protest, protest. You want your coffee? Medium, small, or large? Your butter thin, black, or white? You want the big size, the medium size, the regular size? Do you want it now? Do you want it later? I go by the cash register. You want this change in quarters or nickels? You want to pay it by check or by Visa card? You want this thing? You want 3 pennies or 5 pennies? Would you rather have 2 nickels? I mean, give them a taste of their own medicine. Protest. You want your coffee black? No, I want purple. I mean, put the stuff on the table. If you want to eat it, eat it. If you don't, leave it there. Now, this thing you got to be, it's a contrast between you and the waitress. You think I'm kidding you? Next time you go in one place, see who has the last word. Right before she leaves, she'll think of something. Cornbread or hush puppies. She'll think of something. I went to one of those places, and I said, I want that big hamburger with the cheese on it. And they said, some name, I can't remember the name right now, but some crazy name, you know, like the Uncle Wiggly special, you know. I said, no, the big one with the cheese. Oh, that's the Uncle Wiggly. I said, I don't want Uncle Wiggly. I want the big one with the cheese on it. I mean, I get tired of that stuff. I mean, I went through the other day. I've had this happen twice. I go through there, beep, the machine, beep, you know, security, beep. I don't like machines that talk. I wouldn't have a car that beeped at me. You know, when you get in, beep, your belt isn't on, beep, your lights are on, beep, you forgot your key, beep, your door is locked, beep. I tell them, shut up, shut up, shut up, shut up, shut up. Beep, shut up. I don't want to hear nothing about it. I can't stand a machine that talks back at you. And you go through there and that machine goes beep, you know, and the lady says, what is it? I said, nothing empty your pockets, nothing in my pockets, lady. Well, it's buzzing. I says, from my belt buckle. She says, well, take off your belt. I said, you want my pants with it? I mean, the very idea of a grown woman you don't even know in public telling you to take off your belt. Why, you floozy, nuts to you. Amen, amen, amen. And folks say, oh, well, Ruckman, you're just mean. No, I've had time to think this thing over. And little by little, they encroach on your privileges, your liberties, and they take one from you at a time, and the first thing you know, you haven't got any left. Protest, brother, protest. Be uncooperative. I go in there, please wait to be seated, you know, that kind of thing. I go in and sit down. She says, I'm sorry you can't sit there. I say, okay, good day, and get up and walk out.
That's right.
I don't care if she bought the water and put it down on the table. It makes no difference to me. I'm paying for the seat. I'll take the seat I jolly well please. I went one of those places that you can't sit there. You have to sit over here. I said, lady, I've got to read about 20,000 words a day, and my eyes aren't too good at my age, and I'm about to go blind just to line up with how you've got this restaurant lined up. And she said, well, we're not serving that table today. I said, okay, you're not serving me. Good day. Got up and walked out. I'm driving a gas station. I'm pulling a gas station in the rain when that thing says, you know, 90 cents a gallon, and then when you get up there, you find it's 90 cents for cigarettes, you know. You know, they put the sign up there so they make you think it's the gas when it's diesel or kerosene or something. I wait till the guy comes out and then gun it off and leave him standing there in the rain.
Amen.
Don't lie to me about the price. Deal straight with me or get wet. Well, it's great to be a Christian, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes, sir, brother. And I'll tell you, I'm an American. I'm an American, real sure enough American. I know communists. I know Pinko. I'm for this country, but I've got any illusions about this country. You're not going to stand up and sing, God bless America and live like this country's living. God ain't going to bless America.
Amen.
You couldn't ask God to bless this country the way it's going, doing what it's doing. You better ask God to have mercy upon America and save some of these rascals what you better do. Americans are ungrateful, unholy. I told people in this country 20 years ago, you're going to be living to see the time you're paying $2 for a hamburger. And folks laughed at me. They don't laugh anymore. I judge a nation's income and its economy by chocolate. Now, I mean, that's not the right way to do it. I got my own way of doing things, and I'm probably wrong on a lot of these things. But if I got my way of doing things, and my way to judge an economy is by chocolate. You know why I do that? I've got a reason for doing that. Doesn't sound like much, but I got my reason. You know what I've observed? I've observed when you get in combat and get down to no food, they give you K-ration. K-ration is a chocolate bar. That's the basic unit. The basic unit of exchange in any country is chocolate and cigarettes. That's the basic unit. You take a fellow when he dies, gets right on his last pin in the hospital and passing away, you know what they give him? They give him dextrose. They put sugar in him. Got them all hooked up there putting sugar in him. That's the basic unit. When I was a boy, they had a Hershey bar about that big. It was a nickel. But that thing they're selling for in your store, they're selling for 98 cents. You know what they're selling for at the airport? $2.50. You know what that thing is? That's 500% inflation. You know what that means? It means if you kept up with inflation, the minimum wage right now should be $8 an hour. You know how much you should be getting off your kids? Each one exemption your kids? You should be getting $5,000 apiece, each one of your kids, exemption. Tax exemption. You're not getting it. Country going down the tubes. Americans aren't grateful, they aren't thankful. I get griping like that sometimes, but my complaint is with a bunch of rascals, it's not with God. God's been good to me. And God's been good to me even in this nation. And this nation still has enough left in it where I'd stay in it. Folks say, if you don't love it, leave it. No, that ain't it. That ain't it. I got here first, you leave. I mean, the kind of people that came over this country, that started this country, were people like me. They people even guns and Bibles and stand up or something and not backing off and keeping your liberties. You leave it. But you ought to be thankful. Are you thankful? I mean, I thank God the hamburgers aren't $10 a hamburger so far. One time an evangelist got saved, got preaching the gospel, and one day he went downtown after he'd been saved a couple of years. He walked along downtown, and he walked along downtown. You see what I'm drawing you up here? Just an average, middle-class type of home, you know. Why, there's a place in the world, well, that's a rich man's home. That's a rich man's home. And this evangelist walking down the street, and he went by a pool hall and saw a bunch of fellas shooting pool in there and tuning in, racking out, and he said, thank God to save me from that. He walked a bit further, and he saw a fellow throw a cigar butt in the street, and he said, thank God for saving me from that. He went a little further and went by a theater and saw a bunch of people standing in line in the theater, and he said, thank God to save me from that. And then he went by a mirror and a weighing machine. He looked in that mirror for a while, and he said, yeah, and thank God for saving me from you, too.
Amen.
If you can't thank God for nothing, you can thank God for saving you from yourself.
Amen.
I mean, if God hadn't saved me from old Pete Ruckman, let me ask you something. What do you think I'd be doing tonight, Saturday night, with this talent, if I wasn't saved? You think I'd be here entertaining a bunch of Christians? You better thank God he saved you from yourself as well as hell.
Amen.
We had up in Alabama years ago an old fellow named Uncle Bud Robinson. He's a Nazarene preacher. Now, I don't agree with his theology, but he's a good fellow and loved the Lord and believed the book, did a lot of good. And you take Bud Robinson had never seen a building any higher than about 10 stories. And he went to New York one time. And when he got to New York and got to New York, he saw the, went down there, you know, and saw the Times Square and saw the Chrysler Building and saw the Empire State Building just been built in those days. And old Bug went around there and looked up in the air. 50, 60 story, 100 story. Went back to his hotel room and his tonsils were sunburnt from looking up in the air. And he got back to the hotel room and he knelt down on his knees that night before he went to bed and prayed. And when he got down on his knees to pray, he said, "Dear Lord," he said, "I just want to thank you that I didn't see nothing today that I wanted." Now, do you know that's a great progress there? Think how wonderful it'd be to get through one whole day and not see one thing that you wanted. That's a great blessing, brother. That's a great blessing. All right, there was a certain poor man, a beggar named Lazarus, laid at the gate of the rich man's house, covered with sores, designed to be fed with the crumb that fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked their sores. And it came to pass the beggar died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. Fellow died. I don't know how he died. Probably some cold winter night. Nights are cold over in Palestine in the winter. He might have been lying down there behind a hedge and getting cold, knew he was freezing to death, knew he wasn't going to make it. Heard some dogs coming along the hedge, you know, panting, thought they were going to get him, prayed they wouldn't get him. The Lord sent the dogs on some other way. And he lay there and got colder and colder and colder, and then he got warmer and warmer. Then he got just warm as toast. Then went sound asleep. Woke up about 12 o'clock at night, maybe a little bit later. When he woke up, he looked up over his head there, and all the stars were up there, studded in the vault of heaven like diamonds in the oriental midnight. And up there, between the crackling branches of a frozen tree, he could see two beautiful angelic beings, and they came down and stopped about 20 feet off the ground and said, "Get a bowl, ma'am, we're going home." And he said, "I can't go home. I'm old. I got arthritis and lumbago and rheumatism and everything else. I can't get up." They said, "You be spy as easy as just get up." And he just stepped out and left that body stuck there to the ground and went on home. The Bible said the angels carried him Abraham's bosom. You say, "Where's Abraham's bosom?" I don't worry about those kind of things. I know one thing. I know it was where Abraham was. I know what Abraham was called. Abraham was called the friend of God. I know one thing about him. When he died, he went to be where the friends of God were. I know that. I don't have to worry about those kind of things because I know where I'm going. You know, Christ said to one of his disciples, "You know the way. You know the way." And he said, "Well, where I'm going, you can go." And you know what Paul said? Paul said, "I know whom I have believed. I'm persuaded he's able to keep the time committed him against that day." Paul didn't have any doubt about where he was going. Paul said, "Absent the body, present with the Lord." Paul said, "To depart and be with Christ is far better." We know where we're going. If you don't know where you're going, you got problems. Every saved man in that Bible knew where he was going when he died. Simon Peter said, "I must surely pull off this tabernacle as the Lord has showed me." Paul said, "I know whom I believe. I'm persuaded he's able to keep the time committed him against that day." John says, "These things are written unto you that believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know you have eternal life." How is it that you don't know where you're going when you die, when every saved person in that Bible knew? Your Catholic friends don't know. They don't know. They hope they're going to go to purgatory instead of going to hell, but they don't know. Your Buddhist friends don't know. They don't know where they're going to make it. A Bible-believing Christian is the only person on this earth that knows where he's going for sure when he dies. Paul said, "For to me to live is Christ, and to die is what?"
Jesus.
What?
Gain.
A J.W. can't say that. Because the grave isn't a gain. Don't you get mad with me? Just because you're stupid? Don't you get mad with me? Instead of getting mad at me, you go out and deal with those JWs like I have, and then you tell me what they believe. I know what they believe. They believe when you're dead like a dog and lie down in the grave unconscious. I know exactly what they believe. That is what Paul believed. Paul said, "For to me to live is Christ, to die is gain." Paul said, "I'm in a strait betwixt two, having a desire to depart and be with Christ," which is what? What?
Far
again.
Far better.
Far better. See? Not just better. Far better. Every Christian is better off dead than alive. Ain't that a thought? A lady said to me one time, she said, "Well, Brother Ruckman, I think I'm losing my mind." I said, "Why that?" She said, "Well, my husband died, and I've been left alone now. I don't have any brothers or sisters. We never had any children. And he's gone now. She said, I'm nearly 70 years old. And she said, I'm just left with nothing but just God. I know I'm saved, but I just, sometimes I think I'm losing my mind. I said, why that? She said, I just feel like committing suicide. I said, oh, fine, you're perfectly normal. And she said, what do you mean? I said, every Christian thought about that. Why, Paul, I'm not going to say he was crazy. I'm not going to say that. But anybody got as much trouble as he got to wasn't trying to be careful. I mean, did you ever read 2 Corinthians 11? Do you mean to tell me a fellow lived like that was trying to be careful? I read one time in that book, he came out of Berea someplace, a Thessalonica, one of those places. He came out of there, and they stoned him like to knock his brains out. And they left him for dead there in the road. And they gathered around him, and the Bible said he came to and got up. And you know what he did when he got up? He went back into the city where they'd just been stoned. Did you read that thing? Not a strange thing to do. Why, in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, he said, I knew a man above 14 years ago, whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell. God knows such a one was caught up the third heaven and heard words which is not lawful for a man to utter. That old boy got laid out there on the ground. His soul left there, went up to heaven. The Lord showed him all that stuff. Probably showed him Stephen. Stephen was up there. Hi, Paul. When that thing was over, Paul said, okay, I'm sure I'm glad to be home. And the Lord said, you ain't home yet. Well, sure, this is my home right here, yeah, but you got to go back down. Oh. Go back down. Yeah, back down. Well, now, Lord, let's work out a deal here. How about a vacation? 2 years? 2 years up here? Back down. 2 weeks. 2 weeks, Lord. Back down or I'll throw you out. 2 hours, 2 miles, bam, down. The guy comes to, he's lying flat on his back on the ground with a camel. Did you ever smell a camel? And a camel's over him like that and comes up. Every bone in his body aching, skin all torn to pieces, scabs all over him, smelling that stinking Near East dust on that road. What a change of pace. You know what he said? He said, I know how to get back up. I like back in that town. Yeah, I believe that. Now, maybe you can't find that in that theology book, but I suspect that. I suspect that. Now, just come on, be reasonable, brother or sister. If God showed you the place tonight, what would you do if you had to come back down? You could see it. Now, the Lord, he didn't let you see it, see? He got you all shut up so you know whether it's there or not. You just got to go by faith and blind, see? But if you could see it and step in there and see that place with no sorrow, no taxes, no tears, no pain, no death, no misunderstandings, no arguments, no crying, no bills, sinless, perfect, and knew you'd never sin again, and knew you could do what you wanted to do for eternity and never have to worry about it, and to think anything you wanted to think and do anything you wanted to do and never have to even check to see if it was right. I'll tell you, brother, it'd take angelic violence to throw me out. I tell you, when I got down here, I'd feel called to preach in the middle of the freeway. Now, you know, some of you folks down here, I don't know what you've been exposed to. I don't know what your preacher preaches, but I can tell when I get into church pretty well what he's been preaching by how folks respond. And you had some pretty hard preaching. Your pastor's been real tough on you. Now, I don't even have to hear it. I can tell by how you act, see? You see, when you've been out as long as I have, you get in the church, you can get the temperature just in about 15 minutes. Because if the preacher's been soft soaping and messing around, the people are all rested and relaxed. And the first time you kick them, then they holler, see? But if they've been stomped on for 2 or 3 years, when you come up there and say something, they just laugh. That's right. Now, I don't suppose there are very many people here tonight that heaven isn't real to. I suppose most of you folks, heaven's a real place. I'd gather that by your response. But I've preached many a times about heaven, had them sit there and look at you like a tree full of owls, man. They don't know what you're talking about. They don't know what you're talking about. I feel sorry for those kind of folks. I feel especially sorry for folks up my age. You know, you get up over 60, you haven't better start getting real to you, man. You sure better have. It's about time. You fellas my age and over, you ever made a fool out of yourself yet, for Christ's sake? When are you going to do it? People get up my age, they get conservative, and they get stiff, and they get formal. I wouldn't die and go to heaven without making a fool out of myself for Jesus Christ's sake at least a number of times. You say, why? Well, God knows I did enough earlier and made a fool out of myself on another bunch of occasions for nothing. And you get talking about heaven, they don't know what the thing is about. I feel sorry for you. You know what I've learned from life? I've learned anything? If I've learned anything from life, you know what I've learned? I've learned there's only one thing that's real, and that's God.
Amen.
The only thing real is what you can't see. Something right there, it'll fall apart. Something right there, it'll rot. You see those lights there? Those bulbs will go badly. You see the car out there? It'll fall apart. You see your wife? She'll get old. She'll fall to pieces on you. You see your husband? Same way with you, too, brother. Same way with you, too. Your hair will come out. Your chest will drop. Your feet will fall. The whole thing, you just collapse, man. Everything you see falls apart. The only thing it don't fall apart is what you don't see. Now, you take, when I first got saved, I didn't know the answers, but I knew the problems. When I got saved, I didn't know any of the answers because I didn't know Christ. But I knew the problems. Let me tell you, when I was 27 years old, I live as fast, probably still do right now, much of the year, some of you doing 10. Talk about ahead of that time, man. Listen, man. I had colored fellas playing piano in my house at 2 o'clock jam sessions in 1938 in Topeka, Kansas, in the white section. Don't talk to me about progressive. They were passing out those cigarettes for the brown wrapper in the bands I was playing in 1939. We were sitting cross-legged in the Iroquois Hotel in Transcendental Meditation in 1947. You're late. And you know what happens when you rush through life like that? You get like Presley. By the time you're 40, you're all burnt out. There ain't nothing to live for. That's what happens to you. Listen, when I was 27, I looked as old when I was 27 as a picture taken of me when I was 50. As God is my witness, the Lord just done a lot for me. Just kept my face in that book. There's something that comes off that book and it renews you. It keeps you going. But when I was 27, let me tell you, I was a ramming wreck from Georgia Tech, boy. And I, at 27 years old, I knew something. You know what I knew? I knew it wasn't down here. Some of you still think it is. It isn't. Now, I don't have to get me wrong. I'm no pessimist. I enjoy life much as anybody you ever saw. Probably for my age, I better get as much out of life as any man on this earth. Maybe more. I'm downright carnal, man. Carnal. I still play racquetball. I still play softball, hockey, ice hockey. I played goalie about 2 months ago up there in Michigan. At home, I've got a 400-yard gill net. You know, downright carnal. Worldly. I enjoy life, man. But I got good sense. I know what's ahead. You know what's ahead? Hospital beds and graves. That's what's ahead. I started as a young man. I went through cowboy copas and Tex Ritter and Eddie Arnold and Hank Penny and Hank Snow and Roy Acuff and all that bunch, and came out and went out through Benny Goodman and Stan Kenton and Artie Shaw and Tommy and Jimmy Dorsey, and wound up with Andre Costellanis, went out through Bach and Beethoven and Brahms and Schumann and Mendelssohn and Rimsky-Korsakov and Handel. When I got through, I was just as empty and dry as the bottom of a Cracker Barrel.
Yeah.
And I began drawing pictures and began to copy Maggie and Jiggs and copy Popeye and Mickey Mouse, and pretty soon I began to draw after Flash Gordon and Alex Raymond, and studied the styles of the pointillists and the abstractionists and the surrealists, and began to study Picasso, and then I studied Rembrandt, and then Rumert, and then Tintoretto, and then Van Gogh, and Toulouse-Lautrec, and went off through the French Impressionists, wound up with Michelangelo, and the whole bunch of them. When I got all through, my soul was just dead and dry and barren, as famished as the inside of a hollow bowl with nothing in it. And then I found Jesus Christ. And I got what I was looking for. It works. Walking along life's road one day, I heard a voice so sweetly say, they're building a mansion in heaven for thee. 'Tis a beautiful, beautiful home. Home, sweet home.
Hey!
Home, sweet home. Where I'll never roam. I see the light of that city so bright. 'Tis my home, sweet home.
Hey!
Life's day is short, I soon must go to be with him who loved me so. I see in the distance the shining glow of my beautiful, beautiful home. Home, sweet home. Home, sweet home. Where I'll never roam. I see the light in that city so bright. 'Tis my home, 'tis my beautiful home.
Amen.
The beggar died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried, and in hell he lifted his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off, and said, send Lazarus, and dip the tip of his finger in water, and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this F-L-A-M-E. Fellow went to hell, he's burning. Fellow said he went to the grave. There's nothing burning in the grave. No prey in the grave. That fellow was praying. No torment in the grave. That fellow was in torments. Nobody in the grave hollering for water. It's not the grave. Not the grave. Went to hell. H-double-L, hell. Hell. Christ said he went to hell. What do you say? I get tired of these folks standing up, you know, and say, I don't like a hellfire and damnation preaching. Well, you want to thumb your nose at God Almighty, you know, you're not taking any skin off my nose. I didn't invent the doctrine. I didn't believe in it. I didn't write the book. If it'd been left to me, I wouldn't have sent the best that man could do to send him to hell. I wouldn't have thought that at all. I'm a man just like you are. I'd have said, do the best you can, you'll be all right. That's how any man would think. Any man thinks wrong. Amen. All this stuff. You know, one of my students up there, I got some students up there that are, they're rough, boy, I'll tell you that. Some of them make me look like a modernist, boy. I mean, I get some wild characters, boy. We get a lot of good guys. We get a lot of dingbats, too. I mean, we get all kinds of stuff. You know, people, these pastors, all the young people, they can't handle, they send them down the roll off, you know. He gets the dredges of them, all the people that, you know, wash out ministerial, they send to me. We got these kind of a ministry, you know. And I get some good fellows. I get some wild ones. I've got guys that go in the Catholic Church and turn the statues upside down. I better have to encourage you. One of them that one time blew out all the candles, man. And they waved, the nuns came in, those candles blew out. I don't tell them to do things like that. They just thing them up themselves, you know. You don't have to encourage a man. I about got in trouble one time. I said, well, if you put a rubber statue of Mary in your bumper and drag it through downtown, then I saw their face, and I said, never mind, never mind, never mind, never mind. But I could see what was going to happen. They're going to try it, you know. And one of those fellows, he was talking to a J.W., and the J.W. was saying, no hell, and hell is the grave, and hell is the grave, and the only hell is the grave, and all this stuff. And after he kept going that stuff about 15 minutes, this kid, you know, he wasn't telling the truth, but he sure reached him with it. He said, boy, I sure wish I'd known that about hell being the grave. And this J.W. said, why is that? And he said, because if I'd known that, he said, my sister died last week, and if I'd known that, we wouldn't have buried her. We were hung on a tree. Oh, man. Oh, boy, what I'll tell you, man. What a thing to say, man. What a thing to say. But, I mean, if the grave is hell, if the grave is hell, they're all going to hell. Do you think Lester Roloff's in hell right now? Why, he's in the grave. The very idea of saying hell, the grave. When Paul and Peter and James and John died, they all went to hell. What nonsense. They're absent from the body and present with the Lord. But this fellow died, and he was buried, he went to hell. Now, Christ said he went to hell. I don't care what the rest of them said. Christ said he went to hell. If he went to hell, that's where he went. He went to hell. And they had a big funeral for him downtown, you know, and they had all the pallbearers there, you know, and maybe it was a 32nd degree or something, and they had a bunch of folks in there, you know, talking about what a good man he was, and the preacher was a liberal, got up with his collar on backwards, his RSV in his hand, you know, and he got up there and he said, "Beloved of God, did you ever get one of them? We are gathered together in this august assembly, you know, to commemorate the departure of this dear beloved brother. He was a good man, and although he had his faults, there is so much bad in the best of us, and so much good in the worst of us, that it ill behooves us to judge one another. And I'm sure that a loving, kindly, heavenly Father, in his infinite, tender mercy, would never send anybody to such a terrible place as hell. Now listen, if they're afraid to say it, I'm not afraid to say it. Well, the guy went to hell. H-E-L-L is hell. He went to hell. That's where he went to hell. Went to hell. I know why people don't believe in hell. Some people don't believe in hell because their mothers are there. Some people don't believe in hell because their fathers are there. I know some Christians quit believing in hell because their children are on the way. I know some people quit believing in hell because if they believe in hell, they have to witness. They don't want to witness. You may not believe in hell, but your reason for not believing in hell has nothing to do with the New Testament. It has to do with humanism. It has to do with you worshiping people and thinking more of people than you do of God. You don't fool me for a minute. Not a minute. My little girl said to me one time, Laura, she said to me about 5 or 6 years ago, she said, "Daddy," she said, "is your mother still living?" And I said, "No, honey, she's dead." And Laura said, was she saved? I said, "No, she wasn't saved." And Laura said, "Well, is she in hell right now?" And I said, "Yes, she died out Christ in hell." And Laura, about 8 years old at the time, she said, "Well, is she burning?" And I said, "Yes, she's in hell, she's burning." And that's it. Some of you don't understand that. You know why I don't understand that? Because you're idolaters. And you think more of your wife and your mother and your father and your children and your boss than you do God Almighty.
Amen.
That's your problem. And that thing's all over this country. It's just bad in the fundamentalists as any place else. Let me tell you something. That Bible says one thing and my mother says something else, my mother's wrong. That Bible says one thing and my kids say something else, my kids are wrong. That Bible says one thing and my wife says something else, she's wrong. And I'll tell her. And she's sitting there tonight, I'd tell you in front of her. That's how that thing goes. Let God be true and every man a liar. If I was talking to you tonight, how the faculty of Pillsbury and Piedmont, Northwestern and Southwestern, and Midwestern, Northeast to Southeast, and Biola and Tennessee Temple and Bob Jones and Hyland Anderson and Pacific Coast Bible College sitting here, if they said one thing and the Bible said another, I'd have no more respect for anyone. They weren't even that broom. If I spit on them one time, I'd drown the whole bunch.
Yeah.
When that book says something, you can count on it.
Yeah.
Bible said he was buried and in hell. In hell, he lifted his eyes, being in torment. He went to hell. He went to hell. That's where he went.
That's right. Amen.
Billy Sunday said he went to hell. Billy Sunday used to preach when he'd have liberals on his platform just like Billy Graham does. But Billy wouldn't treat him the same way. I mean, Billy wouldn't get up on the platform, you know, and then ask him to lead in prayer and brag about him. He'd get him up there. Bob Jones told me he'd get up there on the platform. He'd walk up and down in front of him like this and point his finger at him. And so I'm going to tell you preachers up there, if you've never been born again, you're going to hell. I'm going to a burning hell like you burn when you strike a fire. Just like you take a match and strike a match, you're going to hell. You're going to hell! Not a bunch of communists would sit up there and pull at their collars and go out the door and one of them and say, "I believe he used extremely bad taste." Yeah, that's right. Went to hell. That's where he went. Went to hell and he's hell and he's burning. So I talked to a no-heller one time down in South Alabama. That's what we call him down there, a no-heller. He's a J.W. And I talked to him about 20 minutes and proved it was a hell. He gave me about 50 verses to prove it wasn't. I gave my fifth verse to prove the walls. We went round, got nowhere. And after a while, I said, "Well, Pump, I want to ask you something." I said, "I know you don't believe in hell. I know you don't, and I'm not going to convince you. But I said, if you did believe in hell, I said, and I know you don't, but if you did, I said, tell me, I said, what difference would it make in your life? And that old reprobate looked out across those cornfields a couple of minutes, and then he said, well, he said, I reckon if I believe in hell, he said, I reckon I'll live a lot different than what I do. That's an honest confession if you ever heard it. The fellow died and was buried, and in hell he lifted up his eyes in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom, and cried, and said, Father Abraham, have mercy, and send Lazarus, and dip his finger in water, and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. You say, how could God be a torture master and let somebody burn in hell? Well, that's easy. Our God's a consuming fire. You say, well, why would he let somebody burn forever in hell? Well, that's the part of his nature that's his wrath against sin. Take your pick. You know what happened to the three Hebrew children when they stepped in the fire furnace? Just as cool and nice as an April day. They didn't feel the heat. God is purer than sunlight, people. He's the source of all the energy in the universe. If you get in there and you're composed of whatever electrons and protons, I'll talk to you on a college level if you want it. If whenever you get back there where he is, you've got the same protons, the neutrons, and composition he has, you'll be at one with him and you won't feel nothing out of place. But you get there as an unsaved sinner, you'll feel his nature. His nature is fire. That's all there is to it. That Bible doesn't say God wants you in hell. That Bible says God wants you up there with him. That Bible says, depart from me, you cursed and everlasting fire, prepared for who? Who? Why, sure, not for men. You never read about hell being prepared for men. If you go to hell, you'll be a misfit. You'll be in the wrong place. While this generation we're living in, they think hell's gotten air conditioned or something the last couple of years. Why, hell is still hell. Well, they talk about it, God knows they talk about it in Hollywood enough. These new Bibles say Hades, Hades. That isn't the word is hell. Well, the King James one that's up to date, these other Bibles are archaic. Said he went to Hades. Whoever a top kick come to the barracks saying, get these footlockers lined up or I'll kick the Hades out of you. It's hell, man, it's hell. You take Hollywood and they make a movie, they call it Hell's Angels, the Green Hell, the Blackboard Hell, or Hell's Jungle, the Thing from Hell. They ought to call it Hollywood, they use the word so much.
Amen.
And you take that thing, they know what the word is, went to hell. Down there in Robertsdale, Alabama, I heard something one time I'll never forget, made a lasting impression on me, I never have forgotten it. And one of those things came up for an uneducated preacher. He was a pastor of a small church up in a place called Lotte, Alabama. And Lotte, Alabama, it must have at least 500 people in it, just a wide place in the road. And we were at this pastor's conference in a simultaneous revival meeting, and all the preachers were getting up and talking about this and that and the other. And one fellow got up there from the First Baptist Church of, I think it was Robertsdale, Alabama. And he was a nice fellow, young fellow, right out of seminary, and kind of green, you know, but he loved the Lord, and he was sincere, a little bit full of himself, but he's sincere. And he got up and, serious, just sober as a heart attack, he got up there and he said, you know, I've read my Greek Testament through five times. He had to tell us that, you know. And he said, I just can't find in there about denying hell. He said, I believe in hell. And he said, I preach about hell. But he said, something bothers me. And he's really sincere, see. And he said, the trouble thing that bothers me is every time I get preaching about hell, some of my best members get upset. So I understand why that is. He's really serious. And this old preacher from Lottie raised his hand up. And he said, well, I'll tell you the trouble there, Reverend. He said, you wouldn't want nobody talking about your home that way, would you? That's profound, man. That's profound. Listen, when you hear a preacher air-conditioned hell because he's about to move in. You folks live out here, haven't you got Robert Schuler up the road up there in that grooming Chinese restaurant or whatever he's got built up there? Let me ask you something. When was the last time you heard him preach a good message on hell? Ain't that a strange thing? You know, back in the old days in this country, I say old days in this country, even 90 years ago, or maybe 100 years ago, a sinner, when he got in a conviction, could find no rest. He'd go into a Baptist church, and the Baptist would tell him, you're going to hell, you've got to be born again. And that fellow would get horrified, run out of that Baptist church, and run to an Episcopal church, And back in those days, the Episcopal churches preach you need to be saved and you go to hell. And the fellow around the Episcopal or the Presbyterian church, they'd tell him he's foreordained to go to hell if he didn't look out. And that guy would just run up and down and he wouldn't have a place to go. But listen, listen. Now it's so fixed, any time a sinner gets under conviction, he can go three blocks and lose his conviction and get into the church. You know who's going to give Brother Reed the hardest time in this town? The preachers. You know what they're going to do? They're going to talk nice and sweet and soft soap you and give you something you like so you'll think he's a mean old fella. That's what they're going to do. That's why it's so hard to do anything these days. You get a guy in a conviction, he's run down, some preacher slap him on the back. You're all right, son. You're all right. No, you're not. You're going to hell. You're going to go to hell. You're going to burn. I may be talking to someone in this building tonight that's going to go to hell. And he said, about that, he said, no, he said, there's a great gulf betwixt you and us. They which would come to us cannot come, neither can they pass by that would come from you, from us to you. And he said, I pray to their forefather Abraham, thou would send in my father's house, for I have five brothers. Think of that. Think of a family of six boys and all of them lost. I've got five brothers. And let him testify to them, lest they also come to this place of torment. Now, don't you know they had an old man? There was some old man up there had six boys, and all of them headed for hell. Can't you just see him? Boy, I bet I've talked to him before. I bet I've talked to him many a time. I bet that old man was a cutter. I bet he's a pistol boy, man. I can see that fella sitting around with a cigar. Well, pusher, the way I look at it. Well, I thought I'd get old enough to choose for himself, you know, and I don't believe in making kids go to church, you know. I was made to go when I was a boy, and I'll tell you, when they get on up to decide for themselves, they'll decide they're a crazy fool. Six boys, one in hell, and five on the way. And he said, send Lazarus. And he said, no. Well, then send him back to my brothers. Let him testify to them, lest they come in this place of torment. Is man enlightening? You know what that says? That says the people in hell don't want you there. I'll tell you, some folks don't want you in hell. I don't want you in hell. I don't get any sadistic pleasure talking about folks going to hell. My mother, unless a miracle happened to her before she died, she's there. I witnessed my mother and daddy for 8 years. They were high church Episcopal people. My father was a vestryman. My mother was raised over in Pasadena, California. She had a Chinese cook and a Japanese gardener raised in a boarding school. She could work any crossword puzzle in this country in 30 minutes. High class folk, boy. If I don't impress you that way, it's because I'm a reactionary. I was raised in it. I know that bunch. You always hope, you know, when they were dying and got in a coma, you know, maybe the Lord did something. Maybe the Word of God got through to them. I don't say it can't happen. Now, those things happen sometimes. But it's pretty rough hope if that's all the hope you got to hang on to. Ain't much. Father died. MIT, Boston, master's degree, IQ 160. I know that crowd! I went to hell in that church and off on for 15 years and nobody told me how to get saved. And I've resented it ever since. I've been mad about it ever since. And I'm going to stay mad about it.
Amen.
All these rich, smooth, cultured folk, I know them. I know them. Some of the meanest devils in the face of this earth. You hope they get saved. You think I get any pleasure standing here talking about these things? I'll face my mother someday. I'll see her. Now, these fellas talk, Dvorak has a piece called Songs My Mother Taught Me. When I hear that thing, I always kind of get a wry smile on my face. I think to myself, boy, if I sang you the first song I heard my mother ever sing, curl the hair in the back of your head. And that was back in 1923. Things moved up fast, man. I couldn't sing you the first song I ever heard her sing. I remember the word in it. She died of chronic alcoholic. I was standing at the White Throne Judgment. Up come my mother, up comes my father, smoking, brimstone, filthy rags, to pop you curse in everlasting fire, prepared with everything. Mama, I told you how to get saved. I witnessed to you. I wrote you letters. I sent you tracts. I prayed for you and you're dead. You think I get any particular enjoyment by talking about it? I don't get nothing out of it. Let me tell you, if there's any hell, I'm getting out of the ministry tonight.
Right.
There's any point in me preaching. Easy way to make a living than this, man.
Right.
Go back, join the army, boy. $1 a day and the work ain't hard.
Never hurry, never worry, never volunteer. Stay away from the other room. Keep your mouth shut. If it's moving a saloon, it's lying down. Pick it up. If you can't pick it up, paint it. General orders. Going to hell. You're going to hell. I don't care what you think of this message. Just don't go to hell.
Yeah.
You folks here, gray-headed and white-headed, don't go to hell. You never forgive me. You never forgive yourself. I don't want you to go to hell. God doesn't want you to go to hell. Christ doesn't want you to go to hell. The Christian don't want you to go to hell. The Holy Spirit doesn't want you to go to hell. The people in hell don't want you to go there. Why would you die in your sins? Why would you go? You know why you will? You're smart. You know more than I know. You're smarty. You know something I don't. You're going to make it. See? I'm not going to convince you. Reason isn't going to convince you, neither anybody else. Somebody's going to hold out. If you had 50 evangelists and he'd still go to hell. And God wouldn't want you to. And Christ died to keep you from going to hell. You're a fool to go. He said, well, send a dead man back to them and they'll believe. You know what Abraham told him? He said, listen. He said, if they don't believe Moses and the prophets, they won't be persuaded, though a dead man preached to them, spoke to them. The one that come back from the dead. Now, do you know how I know that's right? Because Jesus Christ died and rose from the dead, and some of you still don't believe. Lazarus came up from the dead, and they didn't believe. And that isn't the worst of it. And that isn't the most of it. You know what the most of it is? The most of it is, about 34 years ago, God Almighty reached down from heaven into the streets of Pensacola, Florida, into a flop house, 10 cents a bed and a can to spit in, and took an old washed-out drunken instrument and raised him from the dead and put new life in him and said, go tell him. And I've been telling you. I've been telling them, don't go to hell. Don't take a chance. If you don't know you're saved, you come down here tonight and make sure it's taken care of. You're so thin-skinned, you don't want to kneel here for a bunch of people that get embarrassed that way. Go back in the prayer room, have somebody go back with you back in the prayer room, get a cell back there. But just whatever you do, don't go to hell. Well, if you want to think about me, okay. You want to think I'm a fanatic? Help yourself. It's a free country. I could care less. Well, if you want to think about me, you're at liberty to do it. But don't go to hell. You won't go to hell and come back. Audie Murphy made a movie called Set to Hell and Back. He never got to hell and back. And if he's in hell right now, he ain't coming back either.
That's right.
All right, Father, bless the message tonight. I pray the Holy Spirit of God to speak something tonight about these matters. We know you've done what was necessary to keep us out of this place. And we know the only reason you have this place is because you're holy and you can't tolerate sin. You're not going to tolerate sin. You're going to put sin in a white-hot furnace where there won't be a germ left, and the infection won't spread any further. It'll be sterilized forever. And Lord, how thankful we are we don't have to feel that part of your nature. And how thankful we are that we know about the other side of your nature, your love and your mercy and your grace and your kindness. And we pray that some sinner here tonight might take advantage of this and receive your Son as a Savior. Now let's remain heads bowed and eyes closed in prayer while the pianist plays. In a moment, we're going to stand and sing an invitation hymn. I'm going to turn the invitation over to your pastor as the Lord leads him. Before we stand and sing, I want to have you bow your head back there and think for a while and ask yourself this question. Am I saved? Saved. Buddha doesn't save anybody. You never saw a sign in your life that said Confucius saves or Muhammad saves, because they don't. Jesus saves people. He's a Savior. Do you know when He saved you? Do you know where He saved you? Do you know what He saved you from? Now, if you don't know the answer to those questions, get them settled tonight. You go out that door tonight, if the whole Pacific Coast Shelf drops off, or the atom bomb's coming, or the thermonuclear starts, or the bank drops out, you starve to death, know one thing for sure, you're going to be up there someday with Jesus and things are going to be right. You make sure of that here. Father, bless the invitation. Speak to hearts of men and women, boys and girls. We pray that many tonight that might trust Christ as Savior and bring them to open confession. We pray it in His name. Amen. Amen. Let's stand. Let's stand and sing this song. You don't...